Hey guys, this video is about a 2018 ACL paper titled Hierarchical Neural Story Generation, published by Facebook. It demonstrates how you can leverage a neural net to generate prompts and stories based on prompts. In this video, I will highly focus on the algorithm and especially the neural net architecture described in the paper. I will also cover concepts such as gated linear units, multi-head attention mechanism, and convolutional sequence-to-sequence model. If you want to learn more about these cool techniques, then stay tuned. My name is Steve. I'm a data scientist and Kaggle competitions master. Now, if you're new to me or my channel, we talk about everything deep learning, including deep learning, computer vision, natural language processing, and recommender system. I review some great and interesting papers from top conferences every week. So if you're a data scientist or a tech enthusiast who wants to know about some cutting-edge deep learning techniques, make sure to hit that subscribe button below so you don't miss out. Let's start talking about the algorithm. The presented model generates stories in a hierarchical manner. It first produces a prompt, and then generates a story conditioned on that prompt. The paper states that generating prompt first enables the story generator to have a grounding. This way, it doesn't easily drift off topic, which is common in sequence models. It also points out that the standard sequence-to-sequence models tend to ignore the prompts. They presented a solution to address this issue, which I will show you later. The story is generated by a convolutional sequence-to-sequence model. Compared to the recurrent-based models, convolutional ones have two advantages. First, it runs faster because convolution can be performed in parallel. By contrast, RNN needs to wait for the value of the previous time step to be computed. Second, it captures the dependencies of different lengths between the words easily. In a group of stack convolution layers, the bottom layers capture closer dependencies, while the top layers extract longer dependencies between words. So how does a convolutional sequence-to-sequence model work? This graph outlines the structure of it. The top and the bottom are the encoder and decoder. The middle part is a basic attention function. Both the encoder and the decoder are composed of stack convolutional layers. The graph shows only one layer for simplicity. The encoder extracts the features from the source sequence, while the decoder learns to estimate the function that maps the encoder's hidden states and its previous generated word to the next word. The attention tells the decoder which hidden states of the encoder to focus on. To understand this architecture, we need to know two key concepts beforehand: gated linear unit, aka GLU, and attention. Let's go over each. The figure shows how GLU works. W and V are the convolutional kernels, colliding through the embedding vectors E. The output of the convolutional layers is split into two halves, A and B. A passes through a sigmoid function, acting as a gate, determining which part of B are relevant to the current context. The larger the value of an entry in A, the more important that corresponding entry in B is. The sign denotes the animalized multiplication. This gating mechanism enables the model to select the affected parts of the input features in predicting the next word. So that is GLU. How about attention? According to the paper, attention is all you need. Attention can be formally described as a function of queries, keys, and values. The output is a weighted sum of values, and the weights are determined by the compatibility between the queries and the keys. One widely used compatibility function is dot product. In the basic attention mechanism depicted in this figure, the query is one hidden state of the decoder, while the keys and the values are all the hidden states of the encoder. The sealed color in yellow indicates that this text of the encoder input gets more attention than the other text for a given hidden state of the decoder. For self-attention, queries, keys, and values come from the same source, but are applied different linear operations. In this paper, self-attention is used for connecting the convolutional layers in the decoder. These three components are all from the hidden states of the decoder. The queries and the keys passes through several fully connecting layers, downsampling layers, and gated linear units, whereas fewer operations were applied on the values. I'll explain why there are downsampling layers later in this video. The keys and the queries are then dot product and softmax to form a weighted distribution for the value. The weighted values will be the input for the next convolutional layer. The paper further proposed to use a multi-head mechanism to enrich the self-attention information. The multi-head attention is essentially a group of several self-attention functions, and the output of it is a concatenation of each of these self-attentions. It claimed that different heads learn different interactions between words. For example, this graph shows the attention result from two different heads. The input is on the left, while the output is on the right. The lines in between show which part of the input the output is focusing on. You can see that the attention on the left head focus more on the words nearby, whereas the attention on the right head consider words farther away. In order to diversify these heads, they presented a multi-skill mechanism which leveraged the downsampling layers that I mentioned previously. The first head sees the full input, the second head sees only every other input, and so on and so forth. In this way, each head is forced to focus on different part of a context. Now that you understand these two concepts, let's take a look at other tricks in this proposed model. In order to capture the temporal dynamics of the text, they incorporate a technique called position embedding, which works just like a regular word embedding, but instead of a mapping words, it maps the absolute position of a word to a dense vector. The position embedding output will be added on the word embedding. With this additional information, the model knows which part of a context it is handling. As I mentioned earlier, an issue of sequence-to-sequence model in generating prompts and stories is that it easily ignores the prompts and only focuses on generating stories. It claims that it is because the dependencies between the prompts and stories are harder to model compared to the dependencies within the stories. The paper proposed to add a pre-trained model to solve this problem. They concatenate the hidden states of the pre-trained convolutional sequence-to-sequence model and the currently training one, and learns a gate which selects the important factors of the two hidden states. It can be formulated as the following. GT denotes the gate's output, and HT denotes the final concatenated output. Essentially, GT is the linear projection of each hidden state, passing through a signaling function, determining which part of HT training and HT pre-train are relevant to the current context. The paper states that the fusion of pre-trained model acts like skip connection, which encourage the other part of a model to focus on what were failed, for instance, modeling the dependencies between stories and prompts. Okay, now that you have learned how the model works, let me show you some results generated by this model. This demonstrates three pairs of prompts and stories. As you can see from the passage, the stories are very relevant to the prompts and there seems to be some plots going on in these stories. However, the paper points out three problems of this model. First, the random sampling of words can sometimes incur error. For instance, the word can't is tokenized into CA and NT, but the first time should always follow by the second one. In a sentence, it fails to generate NT after generating the first token, CA. Secondly, another challenge is repetition. Although the model generates a wide variety of words, the generated words are sometimes identical to the terms recently generated. Still, this paper's achievement in story generation is phenomenal. I remember 2 years ago when I was on exchange to Georgia Tech, the stories generated by the model of my AI professor do not make sense at all, even though there is barely a syntactic or grammatical error. Nowadays, everyone can train a story generated model to create stories for you when you are bored. This paper is by far the toughest one I've read this year, mainly because it has a lot of references to several well-known papers, which are the prerequisites for this paper. I spent so much time in reading those papers that I don't even have time to play pub. Anyways, thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any questions or comments, please leave it below. And make sure to subscribe to this channel before you go. See you next time!